Good morning. It's such a pleasure to see you here. Thank you. I know it's a busy time of the year, and we're all have a lot to do. So thank you so much for joining us today. It is my distinct pleasure to thank my colleagues who helped bring this time with Dr. Donna Mertens to fruition. I've had the pleasure of working with the Office of Undergraduate Research, CART, the Office of Institutional Research and Assessment, and the Diversity and Inclusion Resource Institute as we work together to contact Dr. Mertens and to ask her to join us. So, colleagues, thank you. I'm going to read a bit of a formal bio about Dr. Mertens, and then I'm going to gush a little bit about some of the things I feel about Dr. Mertens. Donna Mertens is a professor in the Department of Educational Foundations and Research at Gallaudet University, where she teaches advanced research methods and program evaluation to deaf and hearing students. The primary focus of her work is transformative, mixed methods inquiry in diverse communities that prioritizes ethical implications of research in pursuit of social justice. Her recent books include Program Evaluation Theory to Practice, A Comprehensive Guide, Transformative Research and Evaluation, which, by the way, during this sabbatical year, Dr. Mertens has gone to every continent but Antarctica, as she has been asked to literally travel the world to share these insights from her book, The Handbook of Social Research Ethics, Research and Evaluation in Education and Psychology, Integrating Diversity with Quantitative, Qualitative, and Mixed Methods, Research and Evaluation Methods in Special Education, and Parents and Their Deaf Children, the Early Years. She's also widely published in journals, including the Journal of Mixed Methods Research, American Journal of Evaluation, and she currently serves as the editor for the Journal of Mixed Methods Research. One of the really wonderful things about Dr. Mertens is that she teams with a lot of different communities, including indigenous communities, to help focus on ways research can help promote social justice in various communities. Examples include teaming with the leadership of the United Nations UNIFEM initiative to address the Millennium Goals for Women in Africa, in South Africa, evaluating the cultural exchange program for deaf students between Costa Rica and Gallaudet, providing professional development on transformative mixed methods inquiry strategies in diverse communities at the Fitzwilliam College of Health Sciences, Cambridge University, consulting with the Breast Cancer Screening Project for Indigenous Peoples in Newfoundland, Canada, and on early intervention programs for deaf infants and children in Israel for Jewish and Bedouin families, and evaluation of professional development for Egyptian educators in deafness, blindness, and mental retardation. I think it's pretty obvious why we wanted her to come. I've been a fan of Dr. Mertens' work for some years, reading her journal articles and then her books with great interest. As I've brought them into my classes, as I've used them to guide my own scholarship, I have found her to be an incredibly clear voice for how to conduct rigorous research that both examines and expands the knowledge base, while at the same time making sure that the content of our work, as well as the methodologies of our work and our dissemination strategies, create social justice. For a social worker who works at a diversity office, she's as close as there is to a rock star. It's my pleasure to introduce to you Dr. Donna Mertens.
Thank you for that delightful introduction. I feel like I should break into song and dance, but I think it is a delight to be here, and I appreciate the invitation. I appreciate all the effort that it took for you to figure out a time that I would actually be in the United States that would work for both of us, and I could be here to both learn from you and share with you some of the experiences that I've found to be valuable in terms of expanding my understanding of how to do research and how to combine that with a desire to see social justice issues addressed. I will tell you that I am a professor at Gallaudet University, which Sabrina said, and that university is in Washington, D.C. It's a university that is unique in the world. It's the only one with a mission to serve deaf and hard of hearing students. I went there deliberately when I reached a certain point in my life, and I won't tell you the age at which I made the decision, but I have been there 30 years, so you know it was when I was very young. And I, the reason I chose to go there was because I had really felt there was a separation between the researcher and the community that you do the research at that time pretty much on rather than with. And so I looked around for an opportunity where I could attempt to enter a marginalized community, do so respectfully, and then see how that would change what I did as a researcher. Well, I succeeded beyond my wildest dreams, and I don't say that as a personal testament to myself, but because entering a classroom full of deaf students, you think, well, okay, fine, you have to learn sign language, which I did have to learn. I had not met a deaf person prior to be hired there. You had to learn their culture. That's all, you know, that was what I anticipated. But the part that was such a surprise to me, maybe when I first say the sentence, you'll go, that's no surprise, was going in to teach research, and the students would just kind of stare at me like, what are you talking about? Now, that you might think, well, that's a normal reaction. But I didn't interpret it as, you know, it's just they don't know much about it. That's why they're stupefied. I thought maybe the way I understand research and the way I was taught it isn't responsive to the life experiences that they have. And so in that moment of realization, it caused me to rethink everything I had learned about research. And mind you, not throw it away. Not throw away what I had learned, but figure out how that needed to be modified in a way that would allow me to work with them in a research context that would help me understand how we could contribute to social action and social justice. So for me, that was a gift, a serendipitous gift. Now, the other thing that I need to share with you is that, yes, Gallaudet is a university for deaf people, but it being the only one of its kind in the world, it is a microcosm of diversity. We have all the shapes and forms of diversity in addition to deafness. And in deafness, in deafness and hard of hearing, we have all the range of diversity within that particular community. People who are culturally deaf, people who use cochlear implants and speak, people who use more of a pidgin sign English. We have people who come from all over the world, they use different sign languages. When they get to Gallaudet, they have to learn American Sign Language. You know, it's like if you thought about it as a laboratory, you have the perfect laboratory to explore ideas related to diversity. So that's what brought me there. And let's see if I did that. Yes. Okay. Here's a little, we do have PowerPoints here. Do you want to hand them out or do you want to wait? It doesn't matter. You don't have the cartoons on your PowerPoint, so don't worry about it. I hate to spoil a joke before we get to it. Okay, so why do we need to consider this link between social justice and research? I might be speaking to the choir here, but I have lived through some difficult times when people told me that this ought not to be the way the two things walk together, that issues of social justice are of a political nature and research should be objective and devoid of politics. to be quite honest with you, my position is that you cannot separate politics and research, because somebody makes decisions about what gets researched and how it gets researched. And those are decisions that are embedded in power relationships of different forms, and they are, and the use of research findings definitely are political actions. And so when I saw this cartoon of people coming from another planet who said, "We are fleeing racial persecution," and the fellow from Earth says, "You come to the wrong planet," it just struck me that it's pervasive. The issue of racism and other isms is pervasive. And so as researchers, if we ignore that in the stance that we take as researchers, then we're not really being responsive to the complexity of the contexts in which we do our research. And so for me, it became one of those giant puzzles to figure out, how do we address the isms that are pervasive? And why should we do it? Well, you can think of a lot of reasons. I like these particular reasons. Marie Baptiste, you may be familiar with her work. She's an indigenous person from Canada, one of the First Nations people. And she says we need to do it not so we can raise up indigenous people, but because society is sorely in need of what Aboriginal knowledge has to offer. So to me, this speaks volumes of saying, shift focus from deficit. We need to help people who are indigenous to what do we benefit by realizing the strengths, the wisdom that's inherent in indigenous communities. And Bagela Chalisa, who is a professor at the University of Botswana, says, why is it important to bring a social justice lens to our research? It's simply a matter of life and death. She conducts the majority of her work in the area of HIV/AIDS prevention in youth. And when she witnesses the imposition of interventions and research methodologies that are not compatible, not reflective of the African culture, the Botswanan culture, the Botswanan youth culture, the culture around HIV/AIDS, she realizes that there's a lot of money that's being spent ineffectually and that people die. And to me, this is pretty persuasive. You know, first, I might, you know, you might have already made a judgment about my politics and think, oh, you know, she's liberal, blah, blah. Well, I might be, and I probably am. But I don't want my tax dollars to be wasted. I mean, if you get right down to pragmatics, pouring money into something that supports ineffective interventions, when we could take a different starting point and have the potential to be more responsive, more effective, that's a persuasive argument for me. And finally, my friend Pauline Brooks, who is in California, wrote about the pervasiveness of racism and how if we don't include racism as a potential contributor to understanding disparities, how will we ever effectively address them? If we know it's there, and of course it's uncomfortable, and it does suggest that there is an affective component of understanding what it is that we're researching. And so therein lies the challenge to bring topics such as racism into our conversations about research, even when they're uncomfortable. Well, they're almost always uncomfortable. I will recall just one research study that I was doing on in a residential school for the deaf, where sexual abuse had been a terrible problem. The two of their staff members, a teacher and a dorm person, had been put in jail, and their superintendent had been forced to resign. And that happened in the spring, and in the summer, the State Department of Education issued an RFP that said, we need someone from the outside to come in and examine the culture of the school and what the conditions were that allowed this to happen and what might need to change if we're going to reduce the probability of recurrence. And so in their wisdom, they gave the contract to someone who knew nothing about deafness. And then when they realized they had to go to the school to collect data, they called me and asked me if I would be the consultant to go to the school. Okay, so not being one to shy away, I read the RFP, and after I talked to him on the phone, and I told him I was interested, and I said I'd like to see the RFP. And the first sentence, well, when they hired me, they didn't say anything about sexual abuse. And then the first sentence of the RFP just said exactly what I told you. Because of serious allegations of sexual abuse, we need somebody to come. So I called them back and I said, you didn't mention sexual abuse. And they go, oh, I know. But you can ask them if they teach sex education and if they can lock their doors at night. I said, yes, I can ask them that, but I don't think that's going to get at the issues. So I went down there and I met with the four people who were in charge of the school. And, you know, I don't hate white men. I have two sons. I love them dearly. Nobody can help how they're born. It's just what happens next. And so these four white men told me they wanted me to look at the curriculum and they wanted to look at whether technology was being used appropriately. So I know, I see your face. Oh, what? So I said, well, you know, I could do that, but it's not really in line with the reason that I'm here, which is to explore the issue of sexual abuse. And at that point, you could see all the body language change. Everyone sat up, sucked in their breath, and then finally, one person said, well, I think if you ask people, they'll say, that happened last year. We just want to move on. So being an agreeable person, I said, I'm absolutely sure it's possible some people might say that. However, I do need to ask the questions. Because if I don't ask the questions, here's my bottom line. Who will be hurt? Who will be hurt? So this was not a question of racism. At Gallaudet, we would say it's a question of oddism. People who are hearing think they're superior to people who are deaf. And the problem is those deaf people are just very promiscuous and they're asking for it. It's part of their culture. Well, you know, I've been around the deaf community 30 years, and I got to tell you one thing for sure, that is not part of their culture. So while this particular slide talks about indigenous, talks about race, there's a lot of isms that failure to include could be a matter of life and death, could be that we don't really help people to realize the positive potential that they have. And so in my work, I said,
who's talking about these issues? And a long time ago, about the only people I could find who were talking about them within the context of research were feminists, because they explicitly address discrimination and oppression and hidden topics that need to be brought to light and power issues. And as I worked in the deaf community, I realized that there's a lot of parallels in their lives if you substitute gender for, or substitute deafness for gender. And so I actually tentatively introduced the idea of feminist theory, which I don't know how many of you consider yourselves to be feminists or how many of you include feminist theory and so forth in your work, but you know, it doesn't have a good name everywhere. And so I was very tentative about it. I was like, well, let me just see. We can talk about how the feminists talk about research relations and blah, blah. And the students were the ones who pushed me. They were like, this makes sense to us. And women who are deaf would say, this explains a lot, the double jeopardy, being deaf and a woman, but nobody's talking about this in the context of deafness. And so that really started me on the journey to search for an umbrella that was broader than issues of gender, that looked at race, ethnicity. I've been doing a lot of work in the international community, and there's a big surge now of what they're talking about in terms of human rights theories and disability rights theories, use of transformative principles in action, participatory action research, more and more literature, thank goodness, about indigenous theories, deafness rights theories, and queer theories. I just recently had a student complete her dissertation, which was one of those moments when you get the goosebumps, you know. I mean, I don't know if the undergraduates can appreciate it. Professors don't get goosebumps every single time a dissertation finishes, but there's sometimes there's some where you just are almost left speechless. You know, you can tell that I don't stop talking very much, but she combined critical race theory and deafness rights theories and looked at the experiences of deaf Black administrators at state agencies and educational institutions. By the time she finished with her theoretical lens brought to the analysis, I don't think there was a dry eye in the house. And that's research. It was awesome. So looking for this umbrella brought me to the notion of paradigm. And so I have an explanation of what paradigm is. Woman is trying to do her crossword puzzle, and she says she's stuck on 24 down. Do you know what a paradigm is? And her husband, who really wants to be helpful, says 20 cents. Okay, well, that raises another question. When is a paradigm worth more than 20 cents? I like to use that cartoon even when I'm in other countries that don't have American money. I like to use it in a mixed hearing and deaf audience. Why? Because you laughed. You know American money. You know paradigms and paradigm sound alike. You can make that jump. I could make the assumption that you would probably know these things. But if you do it in an audience where they don't know American currency, then usually they just sit there, and if they're, you know, trying to please you, they'll go, But I can tell they don't get it. So I'll say, well, would it help if I tell you that there's a coin in the United States? It's called a dime. It's worth 10 cents. If you have two of them, a pair of them, they are 20 cents. And so we would say pair of dimes. And then they kind of giggle. But if I have deaf people in the audience, they still don't get it, because they never heard paradigm or paradigms. So they don't know those two things sound alike. When you look at the two words and you've never heard them, the joke is lost. So I don't try to explain it to them. I have the hearing people try to explain it to them. And what does this do? It raises our awareness of the way we use language, of the assumptions that we make, that when we use certain terms in different contexts with different cultures, that people understand what we're saying. And yet, it really puts upon us a responsibility to be critically reflexive about the language that we use within different cultural contexts. So I will share with you paradigms in the terms that I use them here, and I will do like a multiple choice quiz with you. Okay, I build on the work of Guba and Lincoln, and there, don't start sweating, the quiz is really easy. There are five categories of philosophical assumptions that define a paradigm within social science. And starting with the philosophical assumption of axiology and the nature of ethics. Then the philosophical assumption related to the nature of reality, the ontological assumption. The philosophical assumption related to the nature of knowledge and the relationship between the knower and that which would be known, the epistemological assumption, and the appropriate approach to systematic inquiry, methodological assumption. Okay, here's your quiz. I want you to raise your hand and use your fingers to indicate, one, if this is the first time you heard this concept, two, if you're fairly familiar with it, three, if you studied it. Four, if you're comfortable with it. Five, if you wrote a book about it. So do I need to repeat those? I'd like to see your fingers. Okay, good. So we have quite a range of people here. Look for the people with the fours and fives and ask them afterwards what I said. Okay, the research world is sometimes divided into paradigms, and these are thought of as people who hold different kinds of assumptions about ethics, reality, epistemology, and methodology. If we were to paint a very simplistic picture and to ignore a great deal of the scholarship that has emerged over the last 20 years, we would talk about the positivist or post-positivist paradigm that is often associated with quantitative approaches and have as their epistemological principle objectivity. Now, can you tell my bias when I put objectivity in quotation marks? It's just one of those terms that needs critical reflection, should not just be uncritically accepted. Also, the constructivists or the interpretivists, who are often associated with multiple socially constructed realities and qualitative approaches to research. So, are these paradigms familiar to you? You can all nod your heads if you don't want to raise your hands. All right, great. Everyone's head's nodding. They're either falling asleep or they have heard of this. So, can these paradigms be used to address issues of social justice?
Certainly they can.
Have they always been used for that purpose? No, they have not. And we could think of many reasons why this might be so. That would drag us away from the topic that we're talking about today. And so what I want to do is just share with you quickly why I think we need a paradigm that is more specifically focused on social justice issues. Why? Because our evidence lacks a certain credibility, and I thought it was captured here. The fellow's going, let me give you some advice on marriage, Joe. You've never been married, Bob. Exactly, that gives me a more objective point of view. So you don't need any experience to be an expert? Okay, let me put it this way. Try to think of me as the Pope. Okay, if you're Catholic and you're offended, I'm sorry. I'm Catholic too, but it didn't offend me. I thought it points out that saying we're objective when it becomes a stand-in for saying, I have no real experience with that, it's not the best person to take advice from. So there came the transformative paradigm, which had a set of assumptions related to ethics that included the identification and respect for cultural norms and a very explicit ethical demand that our research support human rights and social justice and that we engage in reciprocal behavior with the communities in which we conduct our research or with which we give back. Ontologically, not accepting that there is one version of reality waiting there, or that there's multiple socially constructed realities, but there are versions of reality. And those versions of reality come from different positions of power. And privileging certain versions of reality over others, like deaf people are promiscuous, they ask for it, it's part of their culture, you could privilege that version of reality unless you recognized that that sustains an oppressive status quo. And our job as researchers are to uncover that version or those versions that sustain oppression and to make visible those versions that have potential for social justice. Epistemologically, clearly, we need to be in an interactive relationship. We need to understand the culture, the diversity within that culture, the power relationships. We need mechanisms for addressing those. We need to be able to develop relationships with the people in our research that are sufficient that they feel safe sharing with us. And methodologically, what do? We engage in dialogue with members of the community in various ways at various points in the research process. We might use qualitative, I'd say we always have to use qualitative, and we might use quantitative. We might use a mixed methods design. I don't think you can do transformative research with no qualitative engagement. And you might think of, I can do it, but you have those conversations that help you clarify what needs to be done. And to me, that's qualitative work. So while you may say, well, I don't actually go out and do interviews and do this and do that, you might not. But if you're really understanding the culture, you have engaged qualitatively with that community. Okay, I was going to have a bit of more elaboration on these principles with specific reference to undergraduate work, but I know our time is running out. So I'm going to let that be your homework. You can think about that. Just to reiterate the axiological assumption, starting from a position of social justice and human rights, how does that change what we do? If we show respect for cultural groups, how do we do that? How do we learn how to do that? If we provide reciprocity, what are the avenues that are open to us? Does that include giving somebody a dollar or a tea bag? Or does it actually mean you put them in a better position for social change? Kind of a big difference. We're consciously aware of discrimination and oppression, and we challenge that. We build relationships, and we explicitly address power inequities. This is a design for transformative mixed methods research. You might look at it and say, how the heck? But it's deliberately complex because it means that we have to actually engage in clever thinking and engagement with communities throughout the process of the research. We have to be prepared for shifts in direction. So if I talked about, okay, I want community participation, the first thing I'll do is talk to the people in power, find out what their perspectives are. Sorry, I'm not supposed to laugh when I say that. And that might be descriptive. I recognize that I want to use mixed methods because that's not going to be sufficient. So I'm going to go to a sequential design. I'm going to take that information from qualitative data collection, revisit it within that community, bring it back up and say, now whose voice do I need to bring in? What makes sense here? How can I bring in voices that I have not previously paid attention to? How will that change our understanding of reality? And so going through this cycle a number of times of gathering data, reflecting upon it, going back up and saying, what makes sense to do now in consultation with communities, not necessarily exactly the same people all the time. It depends on the type of research and where you are with it. So I know that's a very brief, but I will, I'm almost at the end. Just a summary of characteristics of the transformative paradigm. I'm assuming the clock here is correct. Okay, sorry. The central importance of the work is on the lives of those who experience marginalization. We analyze the asymmetric power relations. We design our research so that it links to social action, not just publish it and hope. Yeah, I know, it's controversial. Use transformative theory to develop. Okay, why? It's not a checkbox kind of activity. It's not, we don't do this just to have awareness and knowledge of difference. We do it because diversity associated with pattern differences in access to resources and opportunities and life chances are associated with it. So when I review proposals for the National Science Foundation and they say, we have both men and women on campus, therefore we will be inclusive, I think there's more that needs to be dug into there to explain why there's underrepresentation of women in the sciences. So having a checkbox, male, female, isn't the accurate reflection of how to understand that. What does this bring us to? Well, I've never been inside an egg. Well, I guess I was once, but I don't remember. And I don't know what a chicken sees inside the egg, but I can only imagine that it might be dark or shadows or something. And if the egg breaks open and you consider that as a paradigm shift, whoa, you know? And so I leave you with this one final thought, that there are consequences. There's consequences associated with accepting a paradigm shift within the world of research. And you might want to keep the helmet on. But I hope that you do engage with this type of thinking, and that I've stimulated some thoughts for you.